pray for Bernard and the Word and the time together, huh? Who'd like to pray?
I'd love to hear Mike Lust pray.
Amen. Okay.
Okay. Oh, Father, across this whole world, Lord, we are gathered by your grace.
Yes.
We thank you so much for Bernard and Hazel, this ministry, and this gracious feeding over these many, many months now.
Amen.
We ask that you'd open Bernard's heart to us, give him clarity and help him, Father, to speak to our hearts. Give us listening ears and continue to feed him, Father, for our sake. Lord, we're grateful, Father. We're grateful for one another. We're grateful what you're doing among us and what you're doing in this whole earth, Lord. Be glorified, Father, as you always are. Amen.
Amen. I have a word from the Lord. The Lord says, behold, I have made all things new. All things have become new. If you'd been there when my son rose from the grave and moved about for those few days and then rose up on high to be seated with me and then to pour out of my Holy Spirit, behold, I have made all things new. You have not seen it. You have not seen all things new. But as you grow in me, as you look to me, as you gain an understanding of the truth, you will see more and more, I have made all things new. I am not old. I am eternal, says the Lord. I am eternal. I always was. I am. I always will be.
Thank you.
And you, I have granted this privilege, an opportunity, a joyous thing to be in me, to be new, to be caught up in things that are new. Despite what wickedness is in the world, I have made all things new, and it shall come to be. In its time, I have made all things new. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you, Richard.
Onward.
Thank you,
yeah,
everyone. Lovely to have the opportunity to again to share. Now, that's quite significant what Richard just brought from the Lord prophetically, because it helps me in my direction. I've been wrestling with the two great significant occasions in the Old Testament in the history of the people of God. Looking at them again and in some depth. One is the significant event of the deliverance from Egypt, salvation, redemption, out of Egypt. The way that the Lord did a mighty and wonderful things, where the people of God, the Son of God in the Old Testament sense, was born in a day when the children of Israel were born and became a nation in a day. And they were called, God called them my son. Let my son go, that he may serve me in the wilderness. So you know where I am. I'm in the book of Exodus, and I'm in the events of Exodus and Numbers and so on. And almost certainly, as you have gone through the Psalms in particular, but not only the Psalms, looked at the prayers, looked at the songs, there is a constant repetitious, so many statements where the people of God look back to that time and the God of that time, and they just, we are not what we should be, but they look back to that, the ways that God moved and brought the offspring of Abraham into new life, and the adventure of new life, the delivery from slavery. The other mighty significant event in the Old Testament history, of course, is the exile. When God used strange powers to bring about the downfall of everything that the people of God carnally had come to rest in. They had come to rest in the temple. The Davidic kingdom, the kingdom, and they were totally carnal. And the Lord God, their Father, grieved of them over them to the point of severe judgment, wept over them himself, and caused there to be at least one prophet, there was more, who wept and wept and wept over the carnality, the blindness, the foolishness, the deafness of the people of God, who were wrapping themselves up in false trust in the temple, the priesthood, the kings. Oh, we won't be destroyed, we won't fall over. The Babylonian will never come into our gates. And in the context of that, God raised up his prophets and he spoke and warned. And dear Jeremiah, of course, wept and wept and wept, and God wept. If you were to examine one or two of the prophetic poems of Jeremiah, you would find that it appears as though Jeremiah's weeping, but it's actually in the first person, it's God weeping. It's God weeping. I always remember coming across some of the Japanese theologians when I read some messages from some of these men who'd been through Hiroshima and the dreadful things that had happened. And they had a pathos in their theology. In fact, one of them, by a man I think who is Kikamori, if I remember his name right, wrote a book, The Pain of God. And a lot of his theology and understanding of God's nature and God's sorrow and God's salvation is rooted in, or partly rooted in, what he himself saw the world goes through, not just Japan, but the world goes through in the Second World War. And of course, we live in a time of war now. And I want to say this quite categorically to you, and I hope as graciously and clearly as I can. We are coming and in the midst of a time from which there is no going back to the stabilities and the kind of life that was even like 30 years ago. Morally, the decline in the world is almost beyond repair. The sodomy and so on is simply the tip of an iceberg, the iceberg of the rebellion of man against God. The Enlightenment experiment has failed. The way the trust of man in his own ability is going to increasingly fail. And the church, with all of its, many of its ways of adopting its approach to ministry, to music, to the kind of services, I would suspect within 10 years' time, the real church will be almost all underground. That the public face of the church will be completely compromised. And so we are at a time that is not dissimilar to what the children of Judah and a little earlier Israel, the 10 tribes with their capital in Samaria. We are in a time similar to that, ominous judgments coming, mighty things happening. And probably Ukraine, Russia is another warning shot across the bows of the good ship humanity as it seeks to pursue its own course to its utopia. And when I say those things, I'd like to take you into a scripture in John, which is by means of a sort of a scripture that Jesus, in the 16th chapter of John, he says something there about the new thing coming. And he says something there, chapter 16, John's Gospel, and he says this. We'll begin to read a little while, verse 16, John 16, verse 16, you will see me no more. Again, a little while, you will see me. Some of his disciples said to one another, what is this that he says to us? A little while, and you will not see me. And again, a little while, and you will see me, and because I go to the Father. They said, what does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he means. Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, is this what you are asking yourselves? What I meant by saying, a little while, and you will not see me, and again, a little while, and you will see me. Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will be turned into joy. When a woman is in travail, she has sorrow, because her hour has come. But when she is delivered of the child, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a child is born into the world. So you have sorrow now, but I will see you again and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask anything of the Father, he will give it to you in my name. Hitherto, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. And so, he's thinking of them moving into fullness. Fullness. Your joy will be full. Now, of course, we don't think of it very much. The passage to receiving means relinquishing. If you want to go into God's new thing, if you want to go into fullness, that is an adventure into the unknown. That requires that you leave the familiar, that you are disturbed out of the status quo religiously, circumstantially, personally. And I believe that it involves travail and a movement. I think of churches. You see, I've just said one or two statements about the condition of the world and the church, and I've implied many things in those statements and have purposely kept them to the minimum. And you notice that part of the passage to newness that Jesus promises in the midst of the travail that those confused apostles are going through involves weeping, sorrow, a grieving. And that's quite the thing. And I don't want to emphasize that too much tonight myself. But you know that the Lord God, so I'm now going to switch back in my thinking. And I want to lead you into a very large picture tonight, if I can. And it's good to do this, to remember, for instance, the coming of the exile and why it came and the turning from God himself to the children of Israel, or shall we say, first, you all understand that at the time, so we're around the 6th century, the end of the 7th century BC, and then we're into the period coming up to 587. Keep in your mind, 587 BC. That is when Jerusalem fell. It's an important date, an important date. When the temple was torn down, when an irate Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian army dragged, you know the story, don't you? You know about Zechariah, the king, who was blinded at the gates of Jerusalem, almost himself a symbol of that dreadful blindness that had descended upon the people of God, that had brought about this terrible thing. And you must never think that God was simply judging his fallen people. He was weeping as he did it. And as I say, many things that it's such a big picture. But you will know that Jeremiah prophet and his contemporary, his younger contemporary, Ezekiel, of course, was already in Babylon, one of the earlier young men who had been dragged off in an earlier captivity, and he was already there. And old Jeremiah, by this time, was getting pretty well on in years when Jerusalem fell, that they both simultaneously prophesied newness. In the part of Jeremiah's prophecy, chapter 30 through to 32, you move into the messages of hope and newness, the new heart, the new covenant, everything new coming. The law, my law, written on your heart. And of course, as soon as dear Ezekiel, the young prophet, hears the news conveyed from Jerusalem, Jerusalem's fallen. And you wouldn't think that was a wonderful thing, but it was. And do you know that he who had been made mute and had hardly said a word for some time, his mouth was loosed, and his mouth, he began to prophesy, God saying, I'll give you a new heart. I'll give you a new spirit. I'll put my spirit in you. And not only that, he began to talk about a new temple. His prophecies become filled with a new temple, and he sees a river ceaselessly flowing. He sees bones. He's told to go into the valley of the dry bones. All of this comes after the fall of Jerusalem. Newness. Hallelujah. And you know, if I take you into Luke's gospel, for instance, and if I take you there to something very, very wonderful, I think, chapter 6 of Luke's gospel. And if you look here at Jesus in verse 12, he went up to a mountain to pray, and all night he continued in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called his disciples and chose from them 12. And verse 17, and he came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. Hallelujah. When was the last time you saw the prophetic ministry that truly is dealing with demons? I wonder when you last saw that, or if ever you have. The ministry that gets down to the spirit of things, not the cerebral, but the spirit of things. That's what's happening. All the crowd sought to touch him, for power came forth from him and healed them all. Not words came forth from him only, not teaching. I've said again and again, and I think some people get fed up with me, but I said again and again, one of the problems of the church of today is that the truly prophetic ministry that gets down to the spirit of man, to the spiritual roots of things, that's what true prophetic ministry is. True prophetic ministry has a poetic content that it negates the necessity to argue and counter argue. It forces the hearer to shut up and listen. Shut up. Be quiet. Hear him. Peter, be quiet. You've just heard, you've just seen something of such profound spiritual reality high up on the mountain top with Jesus transfigured and talking. Now be quiet and hear him. This is my son. Unfortunately, the church has been filled with the teacher. The teacher. And here's the prophet, Jesus, the apostle of our faith, speaking, going right into spirit. And when he then begins to speak, he's down on the level plain. Here's something that you could see very clearly, that he lifted up his eyes, verse 20, on his disciples and said, blessed are you poor, for yours, you're getting into the realm of God. Yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you that hunger now. Now. For you shall be satisfied. Blessed are you that weep now. For you shall laugh. You shall laugh. The now moment. Now I'm going to swing back. Having read that, you see what he's telling them about now. Now, how are you feeling about the world you're living in? How much of the prophetic spirit is working in your heart? Now, I'm not encouraging people to walk around with faces like, in Ireland, you'd say like a lurgan spade. You don't know what a lurgan spade is, but you can imagine a long face. I'm not encouraging that you walk around, but that you let your heart come into tune with God. Do you think that with joy and delight he's going to burn up this earth? In one way, yes. In another way, no. No. Blessed are you that weep now. If I swing you back into the days of the exile, and I bring to your attention this fact. Jeremiah was from a priestly family who was not a priest. And Ezekiel was of a priestly family who thought like a priest and in his heart was a priest. And both of them were priests in heart. And some of you might remember something that the Lord said through Malachi, where he specifically talks to the priests. And you may remember this, that as he talks to the priests, he encourages them and tells them that they're not weeping before the altar. They're not weeping before the altar for the states into which things in the nation has fallen. Quite remarkable. Quite remarkable. Blessed are those who weep now, beginning to touch and taste something of the grief of God over his lost world. Amen. So, let me move away from those sorts of thoughts. And so rather than just amplifying that, it could be amplified for the whole session we've got together. But let me go back. So you will appreciate from the exile side of things, you realize that newness can only come through loss, the breakdown of that which has failed. And so much of God's grief is over the fact that they wouldn't let it go. They wanted to cling to their temple as they'd had it. They wanted to cling to their meetings as they had it. They wanted to cling to their David King as they'd had him and his offspring. They wanted to cling to the familiar. They trusted in the city, the city, the city, the religion, the religion, the religion, the daily habits, the daily habits, the things that they'd had. And they, when they heard, and I don't know whether it dawned on you that Jeremiah, that prophet Jeremiah, even, you remember he came from a town called Anathoth? Did you know, remember that? He came from Anathoth. Did you know that all the men of Anathoth turned against him? Did you know that the kings turned against him? Did you know that he wrote out some of his prophecies or dictated them, and they were taken in a scroll to the king, and they were read out to the king? And you know what the king did with the words of prophecy, that the Babylonian was going to come and that the city would fall, and the king screwed them up and put them in the fire. It was winter time. He was sitting by a fire. And Jeremiah grieved over it all and had them written out all over again and taken back again. And it's quite remarkable just to ponder these things and let them come into our hearts. And yet, as it fell, newness came. Newness came. The promise of newness. Hope was given. Hallelujah. It's a pretty hefty word. And as I look at this, I think of our dear Lord Jesus coming, and how he was rejected. By who, principally? By who? Have you thought about that? I'm sure you've noticed it, haven't you? So that, you know, if you look in Luke chapter 5, for instance, the Lord Jesus comes, and it would be an interesting thing just to go through Luke 5 on this. Jesus bringing newness. Lovely, really. By a series of events, very personal. Here's a fisherman friend of Peter, named Peter, in the first little story of chapter 5 of Luke. You know, Jesus asked to be put in Peter's boat, and you know how he teaches from the boat, and he sat down and taught the people. And when he'd ceased speaking, I mean, Peter had been out fishing all night. You know, he's on familiar territory. He's in his hometown. He's in his home place. He's just there. He's comfortable. He'd already been called and he'd gone back to his fishing. He didn't realize, of course. You understand that? He'd already been called a good while earlier and he'd gone back to his fishing. And he didn't realize that Jesus wanted to call him into something absolutely new, an adventure such as he never dreamed of. Do you and I believe that even some of us oldest, you know, pushing on in years, there's that which is new that he has for us? He has something new. There's an adventure. You've got to hazard yourself. You've got to respond. And Peter had gone back. And anyway, there he is. Jesus says, now put out into the deep. You know the story ever so well. And let down your nets for a catch. You know, you can just imagine Peter, can't you? Oh, what does this landlubber know about fishing? You know, all right, he's quite a teacher, you know, and all the rest of it. What does he know about fishing? Let down. Well, we've been out there all night. We caught nothing, you know. And isn't it tremendous how Jesus, they obey, you know, a certain reluctance, you sense. And down goes the net, and up it comes with an immense catch of fish. They have to get their friends to come across and help. And then this lovely thing happens with Peter. Don't you love him for it? Verse 8 of chapter 5. when Simon Peter saw it. Now, if you look carefully in your Bible, you will find it doesn't say he saw it. It says he saw. The word it is not in there. He saw. And the word for saw is something quite significant. He had a revelation. He saw something he'd never seen before. And what he saw was about himself, because he saw more clearly who Jesus really is. And in the light of what he saw about Jesus, not just a teacher, he saw that he was Lord. A Lord who he'd disobeyed before by going back after being called, come and follow me. He had not followed. Now he sees, and also that takes him to his knees. Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. Path of adventure, the path of shifting into a new time. And it says, as you know, he was astonished and so on. And verse 11, when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. They left everything into a new time. A new thing, a forsaking of the old. And if you pursue through the whole chapter, you know, you will come down, won't you, to the story of him touching the leper, and that leper passing in to a totally new time. You know that leprosy is not a disease. It's a disease that you catch while you're alive. It's an apt picture of sin. Anyway, that's another thing to talk about another time. But you know, then you move on to this occasion where there are Pharisees and teachers sitting by. And there's the healing of the man who's let down through the roof. And Jesus says to him, man, your sins are forgiven you. And you know the furore that that causes when Jesus says that, and the Pharisees and the other ones, the teachers of the law, they're really going to begin to go for him about that. And then you go down in the calling of Levi, and then the meal in Levi's house. Newness coming to the paralyzed man. Freedom from sin. Your sins are forgiven you. Your paralysis has been caused by your sin, in his case. Newness has come to the life of Levi. And here's these people wanting to pull it all back to the status quo, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they won't leave the old. And then you've got the event that comes next, verse 31 onwards, where you have the disciples of John Baptist and the question about fasting and so on. This is new. Why are your disciples not fasting? And Jesus explains, you know, they don't like the newness, you see. They don't like the difference. And then Jesus says to them, he talks to them about pieces of cloth, new and old cloth, that everything he's doing is totally new. He's not going to incorporate the old. He wants to take everybody into that new thing. And he puts it absolutely succinctly, doesn't he? When he says, verse 37, no one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the new wine will burst the skins and it will be spilled and the skins will be destroyed. But new wine must be put into fresh wineskins. And no one, after drinking the old wine, desires new. For he says, the old is good. You know, that phrase, the old is good, the old is good. The Pharisees were saying, the old is good. You know, the people in the days of 587 BC, leading up to that time, they were saying, the old is good, the old is good, the old is good. Do you know this world in your United States, they're saying, the old is good, we can patch it up, we can manage it, we can sort it. We can palliate Putin. We can sort of come into an agreement with China. We can do this. We can do that. You know, the old is good. The old is good. The old is good. The old Enlightenment ideas are good. The way we've had the world, you know, democracy is good. Capitalism is good. No, says the leftists. No, it's not good. And so on. Social principles are good. A milder form of communism is good. And the church says the old is good. We'll just beef it up a bit more. We'll have better zippy services. We'll do this, we'll do that, we'll do the other. You know, the old is good, the old is good. And the Lord Jesus says, no, it's not. No, it's not. I'm going to be new skins and new time. I'd like to bring this down to individuals a moment. Do you believe that? It's always going to be for you like it's always been, or that God has something new for you of himself? Can you believe that? That as Jesus passes by, I've gone through the Gospels on a number of occasions, just reading and thinking of and imagining the newness that was coming. As Jesus came, the newness that came, I've just done it very quickly there in Luke 5, the newness when Peter saw, you know, the newness that came to the leper, the newness that came to the paralyzed man, the newness, you know, the wonderful, isn't it? The newness that came to Levi. How wonderful. Now I want to swing back just to sort of focus a little bit more back, way back there when they came out of Egypt. You know, you know, it's a little bit different there, the story. Because they were in a thoroughgoing bondage, weren't they? And they'd been prisoners in Egypt and for a long while, and they had been conditioned to another kind of oldness. There had been a lingering memory in the hearts of some, kept alive by God, of the promise of deliverance that God had spoken. Do you remember, to Father Abraham, after 400 years or thereabouts, they'll be delivered. There'll be a deliverer. Hallelujah. But, you know, Jeremiah refers to what, how God thought about them when they came out of Egypt. And of course, so if you go into Jeremiah chapter 2, and Jeremiah chapter 2, and he says to them, he says to dear Jeremiah, you go and prophesy to the people now. It's sort of 600 BC, years later. This is what the Lord said. I remember, this is Jeremiah 2 verse 2, go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, I remember the devotion of your youth, your love as a bride, how you followed me in the wilderness, in a land not sown. Israel was holy to the Lord, and the first fruits of his harvest. I remember when you came out, when you came into newness. This is how I thought about it. This is how I thought about it. When I brought you out, when I brought you out. Now, I want you to do a little bit of thinking. Perhaps we can think about this together. So now let's go back into Egypt and think of the word of promise coming, the Moses man. The Moses man who himself had settled down, approaching his 80th year, settled down. He's got a little family, he's looking after a flock, just settled down. Whether God had really ever come drawn near to him during the 40 years in the wilderness, I somewhat doubt. Remarkable. Could have gone that time and nothing fresh, just memory. And then, you know, the story of the bush and God and Moses turning aside, his intuitions all moved, his spiritual intuitions. He goes after that bush that's burning and doesn't get consumed. He doesn't realize it's God, but he is. Then God announces himself, doesn't he? And he goes after God. He's 80 and he goes after God. Now, I'm not talking nonsense here, my brother and sister. Have you got a heart that's still going after God? A prophetic heart, a heart that is ready to go into newness with God. And you're ready to say that to him. And say that to him as you are beholding the demise morally, the demise politically, the demise spiritually, the demise legally, everything of the world in which you live, and possibly the church that you are still part of. You're still going to the gathering. Are you going after that God who burns and is not consumed and says, I am come down to deliver you. I am come down to deliver, because this is what God said to Moses. I'm come down to deliver my people. Now you go back. Go back with prophetic fire. Go back with a heart that is utterly consumed with my livingness. Moses had asked, what name? And God has said, I am. Just tell them that I am. That I am. That I am. Just tell them that. Hallelujah. I will be I am to you. I will make you into an I am. I am what I am by the grace of God. That's what Moses said. I am what I am. I am what I am. And, you know, he went after God. I remember. And he managed to get the whole nation. And he was able to lead them out. And God said, I remember you when you went after me in the wilderness. That's what God discerned in their hearts at first. Not that they went after the promised land. Now, whoever's told you that Jesus came to take you to heaven has only said about 5% of the truth. And yet that's what most people make the 100%, I'm sorry to say. Jesus came to get you and me to go after God. I remember you when you went after me in the wilderness. But he promised the promised land. Yeah, but he said they went after him. That's what he said. That's how he discerned it. They went after him. And then other things got in the way and they got stuck. They went after him in the wilderness. And Moses first, he went after God. And he went back. And he led them out. And you will remember. So let's do some memory on the story. Oh, blessed be his name. You know, all about the lamb and the eating of the lamb. And oh, my brothers and sisters, everything is the living God. And they are to get off their miserable rear ends. They are to stand up. You know, he does some wonderful things, the plagues and so on. And that final night, isn't it tremendous? Now you roast that lamb. You put the blood up there on the doorpost and the lintel and get the whole family together and you eat the lamb and have your backpacks on and have your flat bread ready baked and a bit of flour in your backpack and have your staff in your hand. And eat the lamb, standing up there, staff in hand, and stay in there, eat lamb, staff in hand. Oh, that, you know, that lamb, that flat bread. Don't leave your handbag by the door to pick it up. Have it all ready. And then, when the time comes, get on the move into the newness. Get in, get on the move. Leave the familiar and you remember it clear, don't you? And you see, this is the Spirit. I know it's the prophetic Spirit. I know it's the Spirit of God. I'm not talking about geographical movement for you and me necessarily. I'm talking about spiritual movement to God, spiritual movement to know Him better, spiritual movement to be a living example to others in the midst of a decrepit, moribund world, near to death, near to its ultimate judgments. Surely you realize that God is beginning to come down and look at the immorality, the sheer filth of sodomy and lesbianism and transsexuality. Man has been made in his image, and man is defiling the image in such a blasphemous way that God will come to that point where He will say, it is enough. It is enough. And you and I are His church. And we are His pilgrims. And we are to go out of Babylon in our hearts first, deeply. Come out of her, my people. Don't think politically, O Church of God. Don't follow these false prophets who say, peace, peace, when there'll be no peace. Don't follow them when they say, it'll all get back to normal. Don't follow them. False prophets, all. You know, go out after God. And you remember how they crossed the sea, didn't they? And they had enough bread. Wasn't that wonderful? They had their flatbread in their backpacks. And then their flatbread ran out. They went out into a land not sown, unfamiliar territory. But God was there, and you remember how God gave them heavenly food. You remember that? He began to feed them heavenly food. They baked their flatbread. Now let the spiritual realities of this come. They began to find God in a way they'd never found Him ever before. He gave them food. Day by day, they were able to prepare it as they pleased. They had to go and gather it. You remember how He fed them. He revealed themselves. Do you remember how Jesus said in His day, wasn't it wonderful? He said, I'm the living bread. There are aspects of God you and I know nothing about as we ought to know, except through leaving familiar territory. When your roots go down deeper than the church you were in, and they go down deep into God, it's wonderful. He brought them out, and He began to give them, you know, and they complained, didn't they? It's amazing. Do you know, Jesus's words so right. The people said, oh, the old is better. The old is better. You know, they said, oh, the old's better. Oh, dear, it's a bit miserable out here in the wilderness. And what are we going to eat? Whatever's going to happen? And they said, oh, the onions and the garlic and all the stuff we had in Egypt. Wasn't it wonderful? The old. No, it wasn't. It was bondage. and then God reveals Himself to them, doesn't He, in the water. Oh, You know, the water dries up. Where are we going to get to drink? What about our animals? Everything, you know. And then the Lord says to Moses, see this rock? See this rock? Just smite the rock. Smite it. Take that rod in your hand and the water will come, and gushing forth, an unending river, an unending river. Oh, the living Christ. And you know, they forgot that rock that followed them. Isn't that amazing? Imagine that. It's utterly spiritual. It's utterly spiritual. You say a rock was following them. That's what Paul understood, and I'm sure it's true. The rock was always there. But they didn't avail themselves. And in fact, they came to a time, didn't they, where they complained again to Moses. What about water? What about water? They went buying water here. They went buying water there. And, you know, they wanted to get water here, there, and they forgot the rock that followed them. And Moses got so irate, didn't he, that God said to him, now you talk to the rock, will you? Now turn your face to that rock again and get everybody to look at that rock again. Let everybody go to that rock again, and you just speak to the rock. And the water will start to flow again there. Speak to the rock, my brother, my sister. Speak to the rock from your innermost being, my sister. My brother, from your innermost being, from the rock of who you are, from that deep inward part of you, and he will give forth his water to you again. Moses, unfortunately, in his rebellious attitude, his frustration with the people, he struck the rock a second time. And that was wrong, wrong, wrong. There's only one Calvary ever been needed. Our rock Christ only needed to be smitten once. Calvary. Calvary is the grief of God, my brother, my sister. Calvary is God's time to cry and weep, as his Son was made sin for us. The spotless one. It's the time of God's joy, the resurrection. And the day of Pentecost, when God was thrilled to pour out the Spirit on willing hearts. Hallelujah. You know, my chief sin. Do you know my chief sin? Same as yours, hewed out other systems. I forsook the fountain of living waters, hewed out alternative systems. His love for us that calls us back again and again and again. And they'd gone out into this newness, and it was desert. It was desert. You discover God in new ways in the unknown realms of desert and wilderness. You say it's wilderness. It's terrible. This bereavement, this rejection, this hurts that I've been suffering, this retrenchment from my job, I've lost my employment. It's terrible, all people of God, you know, Babylon's going to come. Oh, I will show myself to you, the Lord says. I will be the living God to you as never before. I will comfort your heart with comfort. Comfort ye, my people. Their warfare is accomplished. It's wonderful, isn't it? I told you it's rather a big picture I'm trying to paint tonight. Something of a prophetic picture. Do you know what I see? I see that this world of ours, that you and I are going to be, in some ways, forced out of it. We'll hear his call, come out of her, my people. We will find ourselves thrust out, like the Egyptians, push them out, get away, get away. Don't have anything to do with you. And there we'll find table in the wilderness. We'll find God more fresh than we've ever known him. God's always fresh, but we make him stale. Do you know what I'm getting at? One of the things I like about my wife, you know, she's always fresh every day. Of course, there's much more than that, but she's always fresh. You see, she's always fresh. You see, this is God's. We make God stale, don't we? Oh, you know, I've got a. How many of you use that victory sort of thing, that victory reading system? Some of you may use that, you know, through the Bible in a year, old, chronologically old. You know, I think Annie just waved hers in the air, did you? You know, and sometimes you could say, oh dear, I've got to read again, you know, it's another day, it's Monday, you know, and so on and so forth. Oh dear, and life gets stale. How many of us are saying, no, life's not stale, next week's not going to be stale, there's more of God, you know, and we will be leaders, we will lead others out, I tell you. I got a whiff of God through meeting men and women like this. I got a whiff. That's what began to draw me to go after God. Do you understand what I mean? It wasn't the fact that someone rammed the four spiritual laws down my throat. I got a smell of God off the life of this woman and that man and that person and the other person. Oh, man, I got a smell. I got a prayer, and I went after him. Tell me about the God that you know. They gone after him in the wilderness. You and I got to go after him in the wilderness. Oh, yes, we have. And the desert shall blossom as the rose. For you. For you. You say, but I'll meet the devil there. yes, maybe at times. But before you meet him, you'll meet God much more, much more. Hallelujah. Who's ready? Who? Am I ready? I mean, I've been challenging myself, you know, with these things. It won't be another couple of years and I'll be 80. And assuming that I've got a couple more years, you know, forward. Now, this is the word the Lord gave me to give to you. I hope it's helpful. I hope it stirs you. I hope it helps you to see the large picture of God's ways. Oh, blessed Father, there's going to be a new creation you're going to bring in. Hallelujah. Will I be ready for it? Will you be ready for it? You know, Hallelujah. Here's a final thought. In Exodus 19, we'll wind up with this thought. I'll just read it to you. In Exodus 19, when I think of the way the Lord sees things. I did this a couple of weeks ago. I went through the references to the complaints of the Israelites coming out of Egypt. I went through them when they were saying, oh, it's hard, it's difficult, it's miserable, and I want to go back, and all the rest of it. And they're going on like this. And then I went through the contrasting words of Jesus, of God, where God, when he's talking about it, it says here in Exodus 19, verse 4, he says, you've seen what I did to the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. That's just one of them. That's just one of them. I bore you on eagle's wings and I brought you to myself. And I thought, that's how you see everything, Lord. You think, as soon as you see little Bernard begin to respond to you, oh, I'm carrying you on eagle's wings. Let me carry you more. Come on, little Bernard. Come on. I want to bring you to myself. Well, I don't think I'm anything more than little Bernard and a non-entity, but it's amazing. This is how God sees it. You go through some of the Psalms. You go through, for instance, one of the more horrible ones, if you want to put it that way, is, of course, in Ezekiel, isn't it? Chapter 16. Oh, this isn't such a nice way of expressing it. But this is how God sees it. This is how God sees it. When he brings us out into newness, he says, your father was an Amorite and your mother was a Hittite. Verse 4, chapter 16, Ezekiel, as for your birth on the day you were born, your navel string was not cut, nor were you washed. You were a horrible looking thing. Israel, you know, in Egypt, you were a horrible thing. That's what he said. No, I pitied you, verse 5, to do any of these things to you out of compassion for you. You were cast out onto an open field, and you were abhorred on the day you were born, and when I passed by you, I saw you weltering in your blood. I said to you in your blood, live and grow up like a plant of the field. And you grew up and you became tall and arrived at full maidenhood. I passed by you again, verse 8, and I looked upon you, and behold, you were at the age for love, and I spread my skirt over you and covered your nakedness. Yea, I plighted my troth to you and entered into a covenant with you, says the Lord God. And you became mine, and I bathed you. I remember first reading those words with a little measure of understanding more than 50 years ago, before, you know, back in the old college days, reading them with a little measure of understanding. Oh God, that's what you've done. That's what you did for Israel. That's what you've done for me. Bathed me with water, washed off the, anointed you with oil, clothed you with embroidered cloth. It's all poetry, I know, it's all pictorial, but I tell you, this is how God thinks of it. This is how God thinks of you and me. Let's go after him. let's relinquish the old safe zones. Let's the comfort zones. You say, how can I do that? I'm almost bedridden. Well, you know, it's a heart thing first. Some of you can say, well, there are things I can do. I'm much younger in years. Let him draw you, my brother and sister. Let's be those that lead others out. Let's be others. So there you have it. Relinquish to receive. In your heart, go after him. Hallelujah. Going forward means relinquishing and going in to the unknown, which is God. Amen. I've said enough. I hope it's edifying. I hope it helps in the whole largeness of the scripture as well. Amen. Thanks, Richard.